Good morning. Good morning. I'm doing a service today. Pastor and his wife are gone on a weekend retreat. And he asked me if I would fill in today, so I agreed to do it. I will be doing everything from the lectern instead of walking around. It's just easier for me, and I decided I wanted to do it the way it's going to come out the best, and I hope that's the way it is. So, if you would please stand as you're able. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ saves you through faith. The love of the Father gifts us with every good gift, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, who fills us with all wisdom, be with you all. We'll sing the opening prayer day by day. We gather here together for worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In this season of Lent, let us draw near to the Lord and examine our hearts and minds for the ways in which we have fallen short of the glory of God. Holy God, you sent your Son, Jesus, into the world to save us from the power of sin, death, and the devil. We confess that we have failed in many ways to follow him in our lives. We have forsaken the poor and hungry. We have neglected the sick and sorrowful. And we have looked out for our own needs rather than the needs of others. Forgive us, we pray, and restore us to a new and right relationship with you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. All those who believe in Christ are living stones in his holy house. Hear his word of forgiveness and be comforted by his love. You are made new again by the blood of Christ, who gave himself for us, so that we might be holy and precious in his sight. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty God, grant that we, who for our evil deeds worthily deserve to be punished, by the comfort of your grace, may mercifully be relieved through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. God, have mercy. Christ, have mercy.
Glory to God on high, and on earth his good will to all.
Lord, we praise your name on high, worship you and glory. Joyful angel song. You have borne the sins of all. Mercy, Lord, and hear our call. Everyone, both great and small, come join the angel song. Gloria, let the music flow. Gloria to the earth below. Gloria, fill our hearts aglow with the mortal angel song. You alone, the Holy One, you alone, God's only Son, in your name we've just begun to join the angel song. Gloria, let the music flow. Gloria to the earth below. Gloria, fill our hearts aglow with the joyful angel song. You may be seated.
First reading is in the book of Numbers, chapter 41. It can be found on page 152 in your pew Bibles. From Mount Hor they set out by the way to the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom. And the people became impatient on the way. And the people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and we loathe this worthless food. Then the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, so that many people of Israel died. And the people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord that he take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people, and the Lord said to Moses, "Make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole, and everyone who is bitten, when he sees it, shall live." So Moses made a bronze serpent and set it on a pole. And if a serpent bit anyone, he would look at the bronze serpent and live. This is the word of the Lord. Let us read responsively Psalm 107, verses 1 through 9. O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. And gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. Hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted within them. He led them by a straight way till they reached the city to dwell in. For he satisfies the longing soul, and the hungry soul he fills with good things. The second reading is found in the book of Ephesians, chapter 2. It can be found on page 1159 in your pew Bibles. You were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air. The spirit is now at work in the sins of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he had loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel for today is from John chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. You can find that on page 1055 in your pew Bibles if you wish to follow along. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe in him is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and the people love the darkness rather than the light, because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come into the light, lest he works should he be exposed. But whoever does what is true comes to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in God. This is the word of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord. Let us pray. Lord, as we meditate today, help us realize that you are the master of love, and that you are the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. We have the greatest lesson today that Jesus told Nicodemus. It's the most memorized Bible verse and stuff. And we're going to start with the Old Testament lesson because it ties into the new lesson that we have today. And I will be going through just a little more than just our gospel lesson for today. I'm going to go through what brought us up to that point, to where God so loved the world, that memory verse, "For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." What a gift. What a gift that God has given us. And we are here because God loves us and guided us here today. In our Old Testament lesson today, the people were complaining out in the wilderness because they didn't have much to eat or drink, and what they had to eat or drink, they didn't like. It was the manna and the dew. They started complaining, and some didn't believe. Many were bit by the snakes and died. Finally, some asked Moses to speak to God, to pray to God for relief, and God told Moses to tell the people to make a bronze snake, fire snake, and lift it up on a pole. And if they looked at it, they would not die, they'd be healed. We must realize the bronze snake by itself is one of those graven images that God speaks about in the commandments, "Thou shalt have no other God before thee." But we must realize that that snake on that pole ended up with power because God told Moses to tell the people to look at that. God infested that snake on that pole with his power so that whoever would look at that would be healed. So it is with us. We must look up to God and realize he's the one that has the power, not us. In the psalm for today, we are reminded to give thanks to the Lord, for he is good and his mercy endures forever. He tells once again how the people were wandering in the wilderness, and he had mercy on them and helped them find their way to the cities. We are like that at times. We're not sure maybe where we're going. We might have that GPS on our car, but it doesn't always take us where it's supposed to. Sometimes you find that telling us to turn around. So we question it. Just like sometimes we question, is God going to help us? Take everything to God in prayer, and it helps. We're inspired by God to do what he wants us to do. Sometimes when he helps us out, we don't realize, we think it's our own doing that we found our way. But it isn't. It's God's will. God is there helping us. That's when we should be thanking God for giving us the right direction. And when we get where we want to go, we should be thanking him for the safe travel, for leading us, for guiding us, for helping us. When the people cried out to the Lord in trouble, and he delivered them from their distress, and he gave them what they needed to survive, that was really true mercy in action. As you can see, we have a loving God that's there for us at all times and in all circumstances. We need to realize that we don't have to do everything alone. God is always there to help us. The one thing we need to be willing to do, and we don't often think about, is let's take it to the Lord in prayer. He will help us. In our second lesson today in Ephesians, we are reminded that we have all sinned and fallen short of God's expectations. God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love for us, tells us, "For by grace you are saved through faith. And it is not our own doing. It is a gift from God." Now we're going to go into the gospel lesson and the background there for today. And actually, my sermon doesn't start at verse 14 like the gospel lesson was. I started back at the first verse in John, because I think, my feeling is, when I do a sermon, you can't just grab something out of the air and preach on it. I feel you need the background information to where certain verses come from. Our gospel text today starts where Jesus was entering into Jerusalem, where the Passover of the Jews was about to begin. Toward the end of the day, he is followed by Nicodemus, who is a Jewish religious leader and was a Pharisee. He comes up to Jesus, it was after dark one evening, to speak with Jesus. First he said to Jesus, "We all know that God sent you to teach us. Your miraculous signs are all around us and evidence that God is with you." Jesus replied to him in this way, "I tell you the truth. Unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus, of course, was seeing all of these things that Jesus was doing, and yet he wasn't understanding any of it. It was just going over the top of his head. "What do you mean?" he says to Jesus. "How can an old man get back into his mother's womb and be born again?" And Jesus replied, "I assure you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of the water and the Spirit. Humans can reproduce only human life, but the Holy Spirit gives birth to spiritual life. So don't be surprised," Jesus says, "when I say, you must be born again." Jesus says, "The wind blows wherever it wants, just as you can hear the wind, but can't tell where it comes from or where it's going." Just like today. I mean, that wind is strong today. It just enters right into this sermon. "So you can't explain," he says to Nicodemus, "how people are born of the Spirit." Nicodemus continues to ask another question. "How are these things possible?" And Jesus replied, looks at him and says, "You're a respected Jewish teacher, and yet you don't understand these things?" Jesus replies, "I assure you, we tell you what we know and what we have seen, and yet you won't believe our testimony? If you don't believe me when I tell you about earthly things, how can you possibly believe when I tell you about heavenly things?" Jesus told him, "No one has ever gone to heaven and returned, but the Son of Man has come down from heaven. Jesus told Nicodemus, as Moses lifted up the serpent on the pole in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must also be lifted, so that everyone who believes in him will have eternal life. Now we're coming to the gospel area. Now Jesus speaks in a passive voice to Nicodemus in the most memorized Bible verse, which sums up the gospel in one verse, and that's John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Just the other day, we had a funeral here, and I was walking past the bulletin board down in the fellowship hall, and on the bulletin board, it says, this is the quarterly memory verse for our Sunday school students. And it was there. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. That is, as they say, the gospel in a nutshell. The verse of love is a gift that we will not fully understand until we get to experience it firsthand when we enter eternal life. Whoever believes in God is in alignment with God and is also in a relationship with him and may have eternal life. It doesn't end there. It continues there throughout eternity. We all know God loves the world, but we also must be told and know and realize that now, just as well as in the past, he doesn't always love what he sees or what people are doing in the world. We are called to obey his commandments, but do we? I know it's not always easy. We may try, but isn't it easy to not do things that we shouldn't be doing? Sometimes we may be in disagreement with someone else, but we can still love them, and they can love you. If they say something against you, you can still love them. God has mercy on us and forgives us for our sins. So we are taught that we should also forgive and love others. God is not comparable to any other love. God's love is not comparable to any other love. There's none of us that would be willing to give up a child the way God did and still be willing to love everyone the way God does. The focus on the significance of Jesus' incarnation to say that God gave implies that he gave up to death or sacrificed his only son to gain this new life for humanity. The mission of Jesus is not about condemnation, but it's about salvation. Those who believe in and follow Jesus face no condemnation. Those who do not believe in or do not follow him do face condemnation. God's grace is free, and it's God's desire for us to be disciples and go out and tell others the new good news, deeds, and love that he gives to us. Looking forward through the gospel, kind of bringing everything together, if you don't get anything else out of John's gospel, be sure you get this. God loves you. These words of Jesus go deep into describing the way God loves you and how much, not how much, but how. God loves us by lifting up his Son so we can believe in him. God loves us by sending his only Son to give us eternal life. God loves us by saving us from our sins, not just our petty little everyday sins, but from all our sin with a capital S. God loves us by shining the light of Christ into the dark places in our lives, the places where we try to hide our sins. God loves us by drawing us up into the light, so that we do what we do is done in God. God keeps loving us, giving us his own self, even when we don't deserve it, can't grasp it, and don't love him back. He keeps loving us through all our rebellion, through our complacency, through our poor attempts to keep control in our own hands. If this were anyone but God, we'd laugh at how foolishly he loves. Let's remember, God so loved the world that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Indeed, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Now let us go forth in God's love. May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in one true faith through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We'll continue with the hymn of the day. Together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may now be seated and call forward the prayer warriors.
Good morning. Good morning. So, dear Heavenly Father, you are our merciful Father. We thank you that we have been given spiritual life in you and eternal salvation through you. We ask that we don't lose our sight of you by all the glitter of this world. And making idols of ourselves. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Our Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning to say thank you for everything you give us. Thank you for helping me through this service, Lord. And we ask you to continue to bless this congregation with your love. We ask you to help us share the gifts you give us to help this congregation continue and to help us keep spreading our love throughout the world and our gifts. We ask you, Lord, to guide Pastor and his wife back safely. We ask you to bless them and keep them. We ask you to guide us and keep us in your loving care all the days of our life and throughout eternity. Amen.
Before I ask for prayers, I'm really happy today because Paul is back. Such a miracle. God has answered our prayers. He's got ways to go. But it wasn't so long ago, we didn't think he would live. This is wonderful, Paul, and we are so very happy that you're here today. And now, prayers?
Continue healing for Dick.
For Dick? Praying for much better for what? For cancer, yes. I already have them on my list, so we're going to keep praying.
Trina?
For Trina? Katrina or Trina? Katrina. Okay.
Dave?
Dave? Okay.
For Len?
For Len?
Glenn.
Pardon? Glenn, okay. I'm getting old. Anyone else?
The Schneider family.
Schneider family. Anyone else? Let us pray. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you for everyone here today, and please bless them and help them as they go on their way. We pray, we have a lot of people who are sick and hurting, Lord. not only in our country, but all over the world. So we have to remember our brothers and sisters everywhere. Please, Lord, these are our people that we're praying for Austin and Sandy and Paul, that he continues to heal so we can enjoy his company for years to come, and for Barbie and Cynthia, for Sharon, for Al Sessions, that he continues to heal, and my nephew, my son-in-law Lyle, who had similar surgery, for Dick and Karina, for Dave, Randy, and the Schneider family. Oh Lord, please wrap your loving, healing arms around them and heal them, Lord, as you wish. And help us to remember, Lord, all the time to give you our problems and let you take care of them, because you know so much more than we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Now, if you'd stand, we will join together in the prayer the Lord taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated as we gather our morning offerings. Thank you. Please stand as you're able. God of love, you have provided for our every need from your abundant bounty. Grant us grateful hearts that we may give generously to those in need and thereby show your love in the world around us. Amen. You may be seated for the announcements.
Good morning. First and foremost, thank you for singing along, even though there were some flubs. I gotta tell you, I've been watching the Byers kids this weekend, and they are perfect and lovely. They're so well behaved, but they're still, even if they only had like one or two kids, I'd still be exhausted. So kudos to them for being able to do that every day. Okay, this week's soup and scripture is at Bethel Lutheran Church on BB. And don't forget, here at our church on Wednesday evening, we have our Lenten meal and services down in the fellowship hall. They start at 6 p.m. This week, we have the Lace and Finance team providing the meal, and we do need one more team to fill in for our last week of Lent. Not this week, but next week. So if your team is interested, please contact the office and let me know. Speaking of Lent being almost over, Easter is coming up. Easter flower orders are due today. I apologize for not having them in the March newsletter, but we didn't get them until pretty late. There are order forms back by where you got your bulletins. If you'd like to order them for the front of church for Easter, fill it out and bring it in by tomorrow at the latest. That would be great. Thank you. Let's see. We will have our annual Easter egg hunt on Easter morning this year again. If you would like to donate candy, we would appreciate individually wrapped candies. It would be very, very much appreciated. And then I have an odd announcement. Jerry Luther was kind enough to donate a new chair to the office because some of the ones in there are looking pretty ragged. But I didn't want to just get rid of them, because if you want to use it or fix it up, or you want to use it out in your barn, whatever, come by the office and get it. I will be keeping them until Easter, and if they're not gone by Easter, then they will be hauled away. But I would like the opportunity for one of you to take it if you want it. I think that's all I got.
Let's stand for the benediction. May the Christ who walks on wounded feet walk with you to the end of your road. May the Christ who serves with wounded hands teach you to serve one another. May the Christ who loves with a broken heart be your love forever. And may you find the face of Christ in everyone you meet, and may everyone you meet find the face of Christ in you. Amen. Join in singing the closing hymn, My Jesus, I Love Thee. Amen.